Now a certain man was sick, named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which appointed the Lord with anointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, whom thou lovest is sick. And Jesus heard that. He said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Then after that, he saith to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then saith his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest in sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent that ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, and to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been there, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. And Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth, liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And when she had so said, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the Master is come and calleth for thee. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. The Jews then, which were with her at the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goeth into the grave to weep there. When Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying, Lord, if thou hast been there, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, where have ye laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore, again groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he have been dead 4 days. Jesus saith unto her, said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where they had laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that because thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus said, he speaketh and cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot, which was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saying unto him, loose him and let him go. The word of God for the people of God.
Oh, Amen. And to God may be the glory. I am Brother Dr. James Moran, who will be presiding this morning during the homegoing celebration. Next on the program is the invocation by Brother Anthony Woodley, followed by the Holy Scriptures by Brother Leslie Hopkins, in that order, and after that, another musical selection.
Good morning. Good morning. I will ask the gentleman, if you have a hat on, to please remove it, please. Father God, in the name of Jesus. Let me say that again. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we humbly come before you now to say thank you. Thank you for allowing us to be able to gather here today for this homegoing ceremony for Brother Dr. Roscoe Hightower, Jr. We ask that you bless this proceeding. We ask that you bless the family as they go through this time of bereavement. Give them what they need in order to be able to see another day. Give them grace. Give them mercy. Give them understanding of what is taking place right now at this particular moment. We humbly come to you with all prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving to say thank you for allowing us to be able to have a celebration of life for Brother Hightower. We continue to ask all these blessings in your son's name, Jesus' name, and all those in agreement said, amen.
Greetings, everyone. Coming before you to read the Old Testament scripture. We're coming from Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, chapter 53, verses 4 and 5. I'm going to be coming from the King James Version with this. It says, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our Testament scripture. Coming from 1 Corinthians 15, chapter 15, verses 50 and 58. And I'm going to come from the New Living Translation with this one. It says, what am I saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical body cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where's your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So my dear brothers and sisters, be strong, immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. May God continue to watch over his word and perform it. Amen.
Father, help your children. Don't let them fall by the side of the road. And teach them to love.
Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have not done so as of yet, and you have your phone with you, please silence your phones so that we can avoid any unforeseen interruptions. And now for the reflections in the order of the program, that for those that will be giving those reflections have an opportunity to come to the podium where I am, or the podium to my right and your left. And I would ask that you limit your reflections to 3 minutes.
Uh, Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So, Moran,
I know. Here you go.
It's hard to limit over 40 years Amen. To 3 minutes. So, before I start, let me do these because I will forget. Can I ask the SBI family to please stand? Can I ask the FAMU family to please stand? I know that there are also union members. Can I ask you all to please stand? Family, I want you all to see. This is just those that are here in person, not just those that are online. And I know we have students here. Roscoe touched a lot of people's lives, and I just want y'all to know that, so y'all can be seated. Roscoe and I go back. We grew up about 10 minutes from each other. He grew up in Goose. I grew up in Richmond Heights, Perrine. We went to rival high schools. And growing up in Miami and playing sports, whether it was track, football, basketball, you got to know everybody or know of everybody in the city. And Roscoe played basketball. So I would say I knew more of Roscoe through other friends. But everybody knew how smart Roscoe was. He finished valedictorian of his class. And then he came to FAMU. And he was a year ahead of me, so he came in 84, and I came in 85. So although I knew of Roscoe prior to coming, I actually really got to know Roscoe in SBI. And I would say that he was like a big brother and a mentor. He told me what to do, and he told me what not to do. And if Roscoe was on your side, he was on your side, and he would make sure everybody else knew that. So Roscoe and I, again, friends, mentor. And then after we graduated, we both decided to pursue our PhDs. I started mine in 93 at FIU. Roscoe started his in 94 at FSU. But being the intelligent and brilliant man that he was, even though I started a year ahead of him, I ain't too shabby myself, but Roscoe and I finished both in 97. He finished his PhD in 3 years. He took a job in Ohio, in Akron, at University of Akron. But when we had a position opened at FAMU, we were able to convince Roscoe to apply. And he did, and Dean Mobley offered him the job. So since fall of 2002, and I will say, the SBI faculty class of 2000, sorry, 2000, not 2002, the fall 2000 class for SBI faculty. Will y'all please stand? That came in with Roscoe. Right, we're Bates. I thought I saw Bates. Bates, did you come in and fall? You know I gotta call you out. Y'all, we had a bond. Roscoe was known for bringing honey buns and Red Bull. That was his thing. I thank y'all. Y'all could be seated. And we had some good times. But Roscoe wasn't just a friend. He wasn't just a coworker. He was family. We would spend, when we were in town, he was in town, sometimes we would spend Thanksgiving together, and we would spend Christmas together. And then he had his girls. And he would take them everywhere. Janae probably knew more about SBI by the time she was two or three, because he would push her up in there in that stroller. Wherever he went, Janae was. And when Asia was here, boy, the three of them, you couldn't separate them. He had them everywhere. And when they would, we would go to football games, and after the football games, I'd have to steal the girls from Roscoe so that they could have a sleepover with McLean. At work, when you wanted something done, give it to Roscoe Hightower. I wanted to start a facilities management program jointly with the School of Architecture and Engineering Technology. Put Roscoe on the case. Done. Wanted to start a PharmD MBA program, the College of Pharmacy and Pharmaceutical Sciences. Put Roscoe on the task. Done. He's actually the reason I got into administration. He told me that I was going to be the chair of the management and marketing department. And I was. And that started my administrative track. And when I became dean, if y'all know Roscoe, I wasn't his boss. He was my boss. Roscoe would tell me and everybody else what we were gonna do. And we talk about civil discourse these days. Roscoe was the king of civil discourse. Y'all that know Roscoe know. If you had opposing views, boy, Roscoe. This one cuts deep because I know I'm up here as the dean of SBI. But as I said, Roscoe wasn't just a colleague, a mentor, a friend, and a family member that expected and demanded excellence out of others, even when they didn't want to. But y'all, he fought for other people. more than he fought for himself. You had to go to battle. You wanted Roscoe Hightower on your team. His screen on the Zoom. When we fight, we win. Fam, you, the world, because y'all, Roscoe was world, he was worldwide. He was an ambassador in Europe for the facilities management program. Roscoe wasn't just local, he wasn't just regional, he wasn't just national, he was international. And he took students to conferences internationally to Europe. Like I said, whatever he did, and some of y'all may not notice, y'all know he rode motorcycles, raced a car or two in his day. But Roscoe could bake a mean sweet potato pie for diabetics. Oh, he could cook. He was a man of many talents. And when I tell you, when Roscoe got dressed up, boy, from head to toe, down to the shoes, he was matching. Roscoe, I love you. I'm gonna miss you. But you're the best friend person could ever have. Thank y'all.
On behalf of Upsilon Psi, chapter of Omega Psi Phi fraternity, and our line, Tenacious 21, fall 1985, met Roscoe. Of course, we were freshman brothers in 1984, but getting to know him online and these 39 years, and I can speak for all of us here, Roscoe was a one-of-a-kind type dude. I mean, he's a guy that when you hear intentional, deliberate, committed, and passionate, that was Roscoe Hightower. He was deliberate in his walk. He had the most deliberate walk I've ever seen in my life. When he was going to handle some business, and these expressions he would have on his face, he was just, he's one of those guys that you can never forget. And we have so many stories, comical stories, but what's funny about it is, you know how some people crack jokes and they do this and that, but some people are comical when they're not trying to be funny, and that was Roscoe. A lot of the stories that we have were from him. He's so over the top, passionate or committed about something, and he was going to give it to you straight, no chaser. And it would just be comical sometimes because you were saying, I can't believe he just said that. But he was real with whatever he said. He said what he did. He did what he said. And he was never pulling any punches. If he had an opinion about something, he was going to say it. And he was going to say it the way he was going to say it. And he meant it. And we would laugh, you know, and even times that he was cracking jokes or laughing, it was just his, he was just a one of a kind type dude. Of course, extremely smart, but the one thing you always respected about Roscoe was whatever he decided to do or whatever he was going to do, he was going to be real serious about it. Super serious. Like, we trying to calm him down. Bro, it's not that serious, bro. He's like, yes, it is. I mean, he just on a tangent. And if it was something to take on the world, he was going to take it on whether you were with him or not. If he decided he was going to do it, he was going to do it. And but the other side of Roscoe, you could call Roscoe on the phone. You knew certain subjects not to bring up. Because when he gets going on a tangent, it's going to be about 20 minutes. And then he'll pause in between, and then he'll say, you feel me, bruh? And then he'll start again for about 20 more minutes. But other times, he might just call you out of the blue and just give you a 20-minute peaceful talk about something, or he was concerned about you, or, you know, just talking about stuff. And it was always great, you know, having those talks, because even though he was talking to you, you felt a peace for him, because you were like, man, he's relaxed today. He's just chilling. You know, he's not going on a rant about, you know, you couldn't bring up politics. You couldn't bring up, if you just brought up something that hit his button, boy, he was going for about 20 minutes. But it was just good to hear. And the last time I had that type talk with him, and I'm, you know, he talked about his health, and he talked about changes he had made, and how good he was feeling, and he was at peace. And so we know Roscoe's going to be looking over our shoulder. He's that angel that, you know, how you hear the rainbow and you hear people flying around you, but he's that angel that you're not doing right, like a rock or a pine cone might, like, fly down on you. And you know that's him telling you, you know, you better, you know, tighten up, get stuff straight. You know, he going to make sure stuff straight all the time. So we're going to miss this brother. We love him so much. I mean, he's just somebody that can't be replaced, you know? And it's going to be hard just coming to Tallahassee or anything that happens, you know. He's the only brother I know that other brothers will call me on the phone and say, what would your lion brother say about this right here? You know, just trying to picture what he would actually say or do. But we're gonna miss his brother and love him, but we also going to appreciate his life and what he gave and the commitment he had to the fraternity, the commitment he had to his friends, the commitment he had to the school, his students. If you sat in on Roscoe's class, I had a chance to do that one time. It was hilarious. He's so committed. The students, I could tell the students that were really good students when they asked him questions. Then I could tell the other students. A guy messed around and asked him about a week and a half before finals, Dr. Hightower, you going to give us some, is there any way we can get some extra credit? And he looked at that guy. He said, do I look like I'm running for mayor or office? Do I need your, you know? I mean, he went on one of his 15-minute rants. And I feel so sorry for that guy. But But, you know, if you were committed in this class or whatever, you could tell when that person asked a question what he was saying to him and doing whatever. But he didn't take kind to nobody slacking on nothing. So that's who he was, and that's why we love him so much. So as we stand here before, they ask that we say this, which is very indicative of his life and how he felt. Those brothers can come in with me on Invictus by William Ernest Henley. Out of the night that covers me, black as a pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeon is a chance, my head is bloody, but am bowed. Beyond this place, the wrath and tears looms but the horror of the shade. And yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishment the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. And with that, we want to bid our brother not just a goodbye, but a see you later. Because we know this brother will be waiting on us when we have that awesome opportunity to meet him again. And we love you. Your line brothers up here, Tenacious 21, never be the same without Skull. That's how much he meant to us. And we know how much we meant to him. And this chapter and this school. And so we just blessed to have been able to know him. And Candyman was his line name. We all had to have candy in our pockets when we were online all the time, and in case he needed it. And so we always gonna keep that blessing and always think about that forever for that brother. So thank you, Brother Hightower. We love you, brother. Forever. We love you. We love you. We love you, man. And we're going to always miss you. Thank you.
Good morning. As we gather here today to bid farewell to our brother, the Dr. Roscoe Hightower Jr., underdog, Skull, professor, all of the above, we reflect on his life, his impact, and the legacy he leaves behind. He was not just a member of our motorcycle club, but a pillar in the strength in numerous organizations. Obviously, his fraternity, FAMU, Alba Club, the mentor programs he was involved with. And he was also a strength, a pillar of strength in our community. Skull's life was a testament to the measure of a man. The breadth of his influence reached far beyond our club, touching the lives of his friends, his family, and again, the students he mentored. He left an indelible imprint on every soul he encountered. We all know that. A testament to his true, genuine kindness and unwavering integrity. That small dash between his birth and his death, although seemingly small, represents a life lived to the fullest. And as we all know, Skull lived life to the fullest. And I'm gonna pause here to tell a couple little stories that the guys in my club can recognize. We was in Daytona one year during bike week. You know, Skull dressed up in a full leather outfit, cigar in tow. We walking the strip, we probably about 15 deep, kind of parting to see as we went down. And Skull ran into a gentleman named Ricky Gaskin. Ricky Gaskin is a professional racer, makes about $2 million a year, undefeated, you know, a $300,000 motorcycle. Skull looked and say, Rick, I I'll bust that. I'm looking at Sco. So Rick kind of looked at him. They're like, man, who are you? I'm Sco. But you know, I do believe nothing went down, but I do believe Rick, he kind of shook Rick a little bit. And I think Rick backed down. But anyway, moving forward later that night, we was actually leaving probably about 2 a.m, you know, leaving Daytona on our way back to Orlando where we had a hotel. And I guess Sco was, he was just on it that night because we was started out kind of slow. We was getting down a little bit. So some guys kind of passed us. We was all on sport bikes back then. We all got Harleys now. We don't got older. And, you know, we don't slow it down and loud music. Anyway, I find myself doing about 170 miles an hour. Roscoe came by me like I was sitting still. And all I heard was a boom. That was that turbo kicking in on that bike he had. It shook me so bad, but I didn't crash. But, you know, that's who Sco was. You know, he lived life to the fullest. And what this does, this encapsulates a man who loved deeply, he laughed heartily, and he lived passionately. It symbolizes countless memories, shared stories, and the laughter of tears that make life so beautifully complex. As we navigate through the sorrow of our brother's loss, let us remember Proverbs 27 and 17. As iron sharpens iron, one iron sharpens another, and like every other member in, person in here, Sco was our iron. He kept us sharp. You know, we did something wrong, he was on point. You know, when my daughter was on campus, as a matter of fact, me and Sco was in FAMU at the same time, 84 to 88. I went on and got a job. He became Dr. Hightower. You know, but while my daughter was on campus, you know, all I had to do was get Sco a call and say, man, I need something to happen. He put the call in. He called me back. Mike, she good. That was my boy. His spirit will continue to guide us and inspire us. Today, we don't just mourn the loss of our brother, but we celebrate the life of a man who made a difference. His legacy will continue to ripple through our lives and the lives of those he touched. In memory of our brother, let us live like he did, with courage, with conviction, with compassion, and an unwavering commitment to enriching the lives of others. That's who Underdog Sco, Dr. Roscoe Hightower Jr. was. So with that, will the brothers of the Maximum Velocity Motorcycle Club please stand? And so to the family, these gentlemen behind you, Sco was our brother. He became our brother about 23 years ago. I think we established about 27 years ago. He's been with 23 years, and he's our brother. So with that being said, with him being our brother, you're our family. And so don't hesitate if you need anything to reach out to us because we're now family, just like his brothers over in the frat. And I'm sure they understand the same offer. And so just don't hesitate to reach out to his sisters, his nieces, his daughters, his brothers, you know, his fiance. I know, I see that look in your face. But we're here for you. So on behalf of myself, Vice President Don Redding, President of the club, the founding members and the brothers of Max V, we're your brothers. Reach out if you need us. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to share on our brother's scope.
Thank you for all of the heartfelt reflections. And now we will ask for the reading of the resolution.
No problem. To the pastor, family, friends, and colleagues, Capital Cigar Club, will you please stand, those who represent that? I'm here to speak briefly on behalf of the Capital Cigar Club on the life of our friend, our brother, our gentle giant, Dr. Roscoe Hightower. Capital Cigar Club, you will be seated. When asked to do this, I had no idea what I was going to say about our friend, But on the plane ride here last night, I sat looking out the window seat of the plane, and I thought long and hard on what I was going to say. And one word came to mind, and that was consistent. If you knew Roscoe and you know the definition of the word consistent, you know that's exactly who he was and what he was from the first time you met him to the 100th time you met him. You never had to guess where you stood with Roscoe. You never had to guess where Roscoe stood with you. Roscoe was so consistent that every time he came to 3030 South Monroe Street, you knew he was going to jump that curb, park his truck on the grass like it was a parking spot, and we later on said that was Roscoe's parking spot. Roscoe was so consistent that every time he came to the Cigar Club, the spot to the left of the door was Roscoe's spot. That spot sometimes doubled as a south office to the campus where he would check emails, he would grade assignments. Occasionally when he felt like coming inside, the first table belonged to Roscoe, not the chair, but the table. While many of us would try different cigar brands, Roscoe was only going to purchase one type of cigar. And that was the only one that he would ever buy. And if Tom and JJ didn't have it in inventory, man, did I feel sorry for him. Because he was consistent in the cigar shop, probably like he was consistent everywhere else, when he voiced his displeasures. Roscoe, however, was one of the most consistent and loyal customers to the Capital Cigar Club. That when some of us strayed and went to other places, for whatever reason we had, Roscoe would say that as long as someone who looked like him was in business, that's where he was going to spend his money. Roscoe was a one-of-a-kind human being. And every now and then, the cigar lounge would turn into his classroom. And no matter what the subject was or the talking points, we all became his students. And the majority of the time, you all can guess how that went. We all were wrong. Of course, he was always right. But Roscoe touched so many lives in his own special way. And now all we have left is memories. Memories that we would cherish forever. Memories like when Roscoe would walk into the club and JJ would play, "Have No Fear, The Underdog Is Here." Or that time at the Florida Classic when Roscoe helped Otis Kirksey get his tailgate cleaned up way quicker than we all thought. Or the classic back and forths with Drew that were like Venus and Serena playing tennis at the US Open. And then when they were done laughing and going back and forth, we all would join in on the laugh. So many memories, so many stories. But no matter the memory, we will forever remember him for who he was. And we are forever grateful that we got the chance to know Roscoe as a friend. So Roscoe, we say goodbye. You had to leave us down here, but now you're going to the big cigar lounge in the sky. And when you get there and you take your seat, when you see Smoke, when you see Tom, when you see Ken, tell them we all said hello.
Thank you, Brother Hill, and forgive my misstep. And now for the reading of the resolution by Sister Emily James Hammett.
Hello. We have resolutions from the Chi Omega chapter of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. Whereas God, the supreme basilisk of the universe, has called our beloved brother, Brother Roscoe Hightower Jr., to that mansion prepared for him from the foundation of the world, we, the brothers of the Chi Omega chapter of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, pen this resolution in the memory of Brother Roscoe Hightower Jr. To express our sincere condolences and deepest sympathies in the transition of our beloved and faithful brother. from Maximum Velocity Motorcycle Club. Resolution for Dr. Roscoe Underdog Hightower Jr. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. John chapter 11, verse 26. Where it is with heavy hearts that we acknowledge the passing of Dr. Roscoe Underdog Hightower Jr., whom God has called from earth to glory, leaving behind aching hearts in his children, siblings, and a host of family and friends. We, the officers and members of Maximum Velocity, wish to express our deepest sympathy and love to Dr. Roscoe Hightower Jr.'s family and friends. Although we acknowledge the emptiness felt in his absence during our rides, we find comfort in knowing that Underdog is exploring new territory. The community in which he lived and worked will cherish his memory. The FAMU National Alumni Association, where it is with heavy hearts that Florida A&M community mourn the loss of Roscoe Hightower Jr., whom God, the creator of all, in his infinite wisdom has called home from labor. He was an outstanding father, brother, uncle, employee, alumnus, and an avid supporter of FAMU. From FAMU, whereas God, the creator of all, in his infinite wisdom, has called home a loving brother, father, brother, uncle, and nephew, Roscoe Hightower Jr. Roscoe Hightower Jr. was the chair of the Faculty Planning and Development Committee, Scientific Review Committee member, a FAMU faculty senator, and president of the United Faculty of Florida FAMU chapter. From Alabama ANU, A&M University, apologies. Whereas, as a community servant, he gave limitless hours of time serving as chairman of the Community Service Committee for the Maximum Velocity Motorcycle Club, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the Leaders Society of United Way of Big Bend, and as a member of Omega Psi Fraternity Incorporated. The effective and monumental leadership of Roscoe Hightower Jr. has served many, and his legacy will serve as the blueprint for the future. From the FAMU Developmental Research School, whereas the Almighty God in his own infinite wisdom has seen fit to call Roscoe Hightower a dedicated Rattler alumnus, professor, and faculty union president from his labor here on earth to his heavenly reward, it is appropriate to express our sympathy to the family during the earthly transition on behalf of the administration, faculty, staff, alumni, and student body of Florida Agricultural and Mechanical University Development Research School, affectionately known as FAMU High. We extend our deepest sympathy to the Hightower family during your hour of bereavement, and it is with love and high esteem we offer this resolution. From the Jake Gaither Neighborhood Association, where it has been the will of Almighty God to remove from amongst us Dr. Roscoe Hightower Jr., a resident of the Jake Gaither Neighborhood University Park Subdivision, be it resolved that the officers and residents of the Jake Gaither Neighborhood Association do hereby record this expression of sincere sympathy and love for our neighbors and their family during the bereavement to let them know that we are thinking of them and remembering them in our prayers. And from the Preston family, whereas Brother Hightower has transitioned from this earthly life to an eternal life with the Lord, it has left an aching void in the lives of all who knew and loved him. We acknowledge his loving daughters and a host of other relatives and friends. The Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed is the name of the Lord, Job chapter 1, verse 21. Whereas our Heavenly Father has taken Dr. Hightower because the Lord preserves the faithful, let this resolution serve as official testament of the recognition of our earthly loss and God's heavenly gain at the passing of our departed brother in Christ. Thank you.
If I never sing another song down here on this earth, I'll be singing with the angels in my singing with the angels in my new home. If I never sing another song down here on this earth, I'll be singing with the angels in my new home. On this earth, I'll be singing with the angels in my new home. I'll be singing, singing, singing. I'll be singing with the angels in my new home. If I never pray another prayer down here, I'll be praying with the angels in my new home. If I never pray another prayer down here on this earth, I'll be praying with the angels in my new home. I'll be praying, praying, praying.
Let us receive at this moment Elder Carl E. White from Innovation Baptist Church, Tallahassee, our chaplain as well from Chi Omega Chapter of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity, Elder White.
Good morning. Well, the first request that I would make would be from the musician. If you would please give me some of that music that make you pick your feet up and put them down and clap your hands and move your body. I like that kind of music.
I've got my mind made up, serve the Lord.
I've got my mind made up
to serve the Lord. Yes, I've got my mind made up. Let me say it like this. Listen.
Come on, stand up on your feet.
When I was a sinner, I was running from here to there. He kept his arms around me. He showed me how much he cared. He's been good to me. I just can't tell it all. Yes, I've got my mind made up. Ooh, yeah. I've got my mind made up to serve the Lord.
I've got my mind made up to serve the Lord.
I've got my mind made up to serve the Lord. Yes, I've got my mind made up. One more time, everybody. I've got my mind made up to serve the Lord.
I've got my mind made up
to serve the Lord.
I've got my mind made up
to serve the Lord. Yes, I've got my mind made up.
Amen. Come on and give God some praise. I'm sure we can do much better than that. That's enough if you was giving me a hand clap of praise for just standing up. But we talking about the God that made everything. The God that put us on this earth. The God that made this brother, Dr. Roscoe Hightower, Junior. Hello, lights. I don't hear nobody talking. I don't see nobody celebrating. I don't see nobody smiling and laughing and clapping their hands and moving their feet and moving their body. This is a celebration of the life of a great man. See, at times like this, we like to get up here and come up here and say all the little flowery stuff about people, right? Their positions and all the stuff that they do, all the titles that we hold. But we have to come to understand, people of God, that this brother right here was a man ordained by God. If it was not for the Lord who was on his side that enabled him to do from a small child everything that he accomplished. That's stuff that should make a person happy, glad. It's easy to walk up to the front of the church and put on our professional behavior. But what about the man? When you strip all of that stuff away from any of us, and we stand before one another, it's about how we treat and how we love other people. As testified by everything that I heard from all the groups, Roscoe was a dynamic brother. But see, y'all left something out. Roscoe Hightower Jr. was a child of God. He was a child of God before any of you knew him. Except maybe his auntie's godmother. He was a child of God. And see, there's something very special in that of itself. Because it is God, my brothers and sisters, that creates. He makes life. And in his word, it is declared that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody comes through the Father except through him. Roscoe discovered Christ at a young age. That shaped and molded him. But let me digress for a minute. As I look to the family, you have my deepest condolences on behalf of Chi Omega, chapter of the Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. I'll stand here, all has been rendered, all has been said about Roscoe Hightower Jr., our brother, our friend, our leader, our guide, our conscience, our comedian, our director, our boss, our mentor, our mentee, and all he meant
to you as your brother, and to you, Emily, as his niece, his daughter's mother, aunt and godmother, right? His fiance and all the family that is here today to pay their respects to Brother Roscoe Hightower. And I digress momentarily, because see, I'm that guy, I'll get up here and get happy on you. See, because God has brought me a mighty long way. And I ain't no ways tired. I know he's brought me too far to leave me now. And see, today, it's going to be about correcting some things that we think as human beings about one another and about what God does in the life of his believers. Now, I'll tell you, even before I really get to the meat of it, the more you say amen, the sooner I'll get done. If I don't hear no clapping, no amens and stuff like that, because see, I can talk a long time. I can do that. Y'all think y'all got up here with your thoughts and remarks and said things for minutes? Y'all ain't heard me go. Hey, see, them guys, they know. They know. Yeah, yeah. And see, what's involved is that it's about coming together and having a good time. I'm not talking about going out to eat and this and that and stuff later on. It's right here, right now. As we've had the final glimpse and the casket closed on the remains of our brother, our friend, the father, nephew, godson, and everything else that he's been to everybody else all these years. He's not sad. If you think about, you know, Easter was a couple weeks ago, right? Think about the morning after Jesus was crucified on the cross, right? And the two Marys went to the tomb early that morning to anoint his body with spices, as it was custom to do in those days. And when they got there, the stone had been rolled away. And there were two angels sitting there in bright white and surrounded by light, shimmering. And as the ladies approached, the angels in all their light, which was the light of God, asked them, "Why you seek the living among the dead? He is risen. He's not here. What we have here before us is the worn out suit body that Roscoe was trapped in during the years he lived his life on earth and with us. But everything and all the important things of Brother Roscoe Hightower Jr., they still remain. They are not locked there. He has already risen to the kingdom of God. So, you know, take your program, please. and look at the front. Look at the front. Look at that picture. Does that look like somebody that is mourning? Does that look like somebody that's down in the dump? Does that look like someone that's discouraged and distressed and depressed? That looks like a man to me that is full of life and energy. That looks like a light-owned man, that the light of the Lord God himself is within this man. You know how sometimes you can look at people and they look different? Even more different than you when you get up in the morning and look at yourself in your own mirror? Because they have a light upon them. And everything they do, everybody they encounter, everything that they touch is lifted up, is exposed. He radiated around people in their lives. Everything that was mentioned today is true. It's factual. But Brother Roscoe Hightower Jr. was much more than that. Much, much more. For those of you that may be down, please, I ask God to comfort the family, to comfort those that were mourning or having a difficult time with his loss. Because we're here to tell you today, he ain't lost. What makes by anybody think that Roscoe Hightower Jr. is lost? If nothing else, he's really been found. He's where he's supposed to be now. We, the ones left behind, are tasked with the life, the love, and the legacy of this great man. And we're tasked to carry just a little bit of his light along with our light. Because the time that God blessed us to be born, when we're born to our parents, we're born with a light from God. And as we age and as we learn life and experience things, that light gets brighter and brighter and brighter. And it is supposed to illuminate things to others. They're supposed to see the illumination of that light on our lives. They saw it in Brother Hightower. They experienced it with Brother Hightower. They were touched by it, by Brother Hightower. His life is an illustration of the light that God put in his life. An illustration to all those that he encountered domestically and globally. See, we have to come to understand, brothers and sisters, that the things that we do, if it weren't for God, it wouldn't matter. It wouldn't matter. And at the end of the day, we have to look and at ourselves in the mirror and say, what really matters? What's really important? How have I touched or influenced or impacted somebody else in a positive manner? That's what you guys have been saying about Brother Roscoe Hightower, Jr. So, guess what, y'all? That was just the introduction. You think I'm playing? Anybody think I'm playing? I bet y'all start saying it now. Did y'all eat first? Y'all want to take a lunch break? Come back? No, but out of consideration to the family. Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen. Out of consideration to the family, I'm not going to do that for real. But maybe. I look at it this way. If I could sit here all this time and listen to y'all talk, y'all can certainly listen to me. Amen. Amen, amen. Amen. Let's do it again. But actually, the scripture two that I want to bring out this morning, found in Matthew chapter 5. And I'm going to read this for your hearing. If you have your devices, pull them out, look up, follow in the word, see for yourself, make sure I ain't up here making up stuff. Amen. Because we know academics like to do that. They like to track people and follow them and make sure they just ain't up there making up stuff. Yeah. But see, what you got to understand is while you tracking somebody, somebody is tracking you. It's a two-way street. If they ain't tracking your academics, they might be tracking how you live. They might be tracking how you treat people. They might be tracking to see if you got a light in you. So I'm going to read from the Amplified version. You are the light of Christ to the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good deeds and moral excellence and recognize and honor and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Now, the other scripture will be found in 1 John, first chapter, in verses 1 through 5. Again, from the Amplified. I am writing about what existed from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life, the one who existed even before the beginning of the world, Christ, and the life and aspect of his being was manifested, and we have seen it as eyewitnesses and testify and declare to you the life, the eternal life who was already existing with the Father and was actually made visible to us, his followers. What we have seen and heard, we also proclaim to you so that you too may have fellowship as partners with us. And indeed our fellowship, which is a distinguishing mark of born-again believers, is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things to you so that our joy in seeing you included may be made complete by having you share in the joy of salvation. This is the message of God's promised revelation, which we have heard from him and now announce to you, that God is light. He is holy. His message is truthful. He is perfect in righteousness, and in him there is no darkness at all. No sin, no wickedness, no imperfection. And that is the word of God for the people of God. And from these scriptures, just for a little while, I'm a pull as a subject. It's only a flicker. The light stays on. It's only a flicker. The light stays on. Amen. 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 Now, see, I get happy and run on and see what the end is going to be. But it's only a flicker. What's happening today is we have a man that we're here to celebrate his life. He was born with light. He was raised with light. He lived with light. He was the light. Want to know why I say that? Because the word of God says, in the beginning was the word. And the word was God. And the word was with God, who made everything, and without him, nothing was made that was made. And in Genesis, first chapter, around 26th verse, it says, let us make man in our image and likeness. So Brother Roscoe Hightower was made in the image and the likeness of Almighty God. Yeah, yeah. And once you have the light of God and Jesus Christ in you, that light does not dim. It doesn't diminish. The bulbs don't burn out. If anything, it's only a flicker. Come on, say that with me. It's only a flicker. Amen. Because remember, brothers and sisters, that the time we spend here on earth is yet but a drop of bucket to where we will spend eternity with God in heaven. Amen. We got to understand that, and you got to believe it. You either do or you don't. But it's a drop in the bucket. You think when a person passes away, they transition. Right? You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. Yeah, they ready to go. Yeah. But I'm going to tell y'all something. Interrupt me again, and I'm going to reclaim my time. So, we get everlasting life. So, it's transition. They're not gone. They're not destroyed. They're not dead. The body is worn out. The soul and the spirit still live. So if you want to look at it scientifically for anybody in academia, right, from a biological state or physics state, the passage of energy, you got certain kinds of energy, stored energy, potential energy. You got energy that does work. But in this case, what we're talking about is the power to light. God is that power that makes us light, right? So when we pass away, or as I aptly prefer, transition, the transition is from life to eternal life. Life to eternal. 1 second you here, the next millisecond you not. But see, we normally refer to that as death. But no. I'm here to suggest no. Like the Bible says, in a twinkling of an eye, Jesus is coming back. In the twinkling of an eye. You can't count the twinkling of an eye. So again, this light that shined in the brother Roscoe Hightower Jr. has been shining since he was a young man. I thank God for the time that I was able to spend with the family and learn so much more about Brother Roscoe Hightower. Finding out that things we had in common, things that influenced and impacted us both one time or another. So Brother Hightower was influenced in to get an education by his mother. He was encouraged to seek education by her. That is a staple that has passed down to his sister. She told me how she saw what her brother did. Her niece told me how she saw what her uncle did. It inspired and it encouraged them to go and seek the same. So a lot of times, my brothers and sisters, just like this past week when the world was in an uproar because of an eclipse of the sun, right? And they had some news coverage on that about how the moon moves in front, and they call it total resolution or whatever, right? But they showed it that even in the total eclipse, there were streams of light and beads of light that surrounded the sun even at its darkest point, because the sun is so powerful and it controls the rotation and the orbit of all the planets around it in this galaxy, that the moon couldn't stay where it was. It had to get out the way because there was too much light. The closer that Brother Roscoe Hightower got to this way, there was too much light in him. The darkness of death came upon him, but he couldn't stay because there was too much light from the S-O-N passed down to Brother Hightower. So we understand, we get caught up in the things of the world. We get caught up trying to understand this and that. We get caught up evaluating this and that. But we get caught up sometimes checking out everything but ourselves. While we looking at the light and seeing if there's light in someone else, look in the mirror on your way home. Are you lit? See, because everybody here that was touched by this man saw his light. They saw it. And some have been transformed by the light they saw in Brother Roscoe Hightower. We thank God for Brother Hightower. We thank God for his life, his love, and his legacy. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. Hallelujah. Yeah. We see all that, my man. But we at a point right now that if I could have the house lights turned off, at least in the middle here, we bring those lights down. And if, Sister Cynthia, you want to stand at this point, and I'll explain to the people what you would like to symbolize. Everybody that has a mobile device, take it out at this time and please turn on your light. Amen. Amen. Come on and put your hands together and give God some praise. We thank you for this time spent in celebration. But I would be remiss if I did not do this. We understand that the Lord Jesus Christ is our Lord and our Savior. We know that he was betrayed by an evil man, that he was persecuted wrongly, and that they took our Lord and they made him carry his cross to a hill called Calvary. At that hill, they laid him on this cross and they put nails in his hands, nails in his feet. And they raised that cross up. He was pierced in the side, but yet he forgave them for what they had done. He forgave one of the men crucified with him. They said, "This man has done nothing wrong. I deserve what I'm getting." And he said, "Please, Father, remember me when you get to your paradise. And Jesus proclaimed that to the man that this day you will be in paradise with me. So he died. He shed his blood, an agonizing death, a bloody death, a gory death, for something that we have no comprehension of. But yet, he hung his head, he died. He was buried in a borrowed tomb where he remained. He went to hell, took the keys, and set the captives free. He went to hell, and the last thing he defeated was death itself. But early one Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands, all power to light up each and every one that would get saved and believeth on him after that point. He gave his life on Calvary so that we could be light, because he was the light, and we live in the light, and we grow in the light, and we illuminate in the light. Hallelujah. So I extend the opportunity that if there's anyone here that does not know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, or has not confessed with their mouth and believed in their heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, come forth now at this time. Come forth. Just stick your hand up where you are. Hallelujah. Think about Roscoe. He done found something new that he want us to understand more than what we understand now. It ain't no doubt that somebody here need Jesus. Everybody's life is not satisfactory. Everybody's life is not where they want it to be. Everybody's life could be better if you just submit to the calling of Jesus Christ on your life. Set aside anything, any unction that would stop you from accepting Christ. Because see, if Roscoe could, he would jump over that gap, come back and tell y'all, you better get your work done. You better get this done. You better believe. Everything you got, motorcycles, cigars, degrees, fraternities, sororities, none of that means anything unless you are born again. So, as I close, amen. 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 I think I'm going to keep going on because y'all trying to be funny around here. But yeah, we're going to turn things back over to the preachers. Hallelujah. Come on and put your hands together and give God some praise.
Let's give our eulogists a hand clap. Family and friends, we have come to the conclusion of the services for Dr. Hightower. We're currently preparing our hearts and minds to recess from this place, but I do want to just bring to your attention that there will be the final service of a committal and interment for Dr. Hightower on Wednesday, April the 17th, in Griffin, Georgia, at the Griffin Memorial Garden. So to each of you who have come to wrap your loving arms around this family during this time, they simply say thank you. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for any and all acts of kindness that you have shown them. during this difficult time. At a later date, when time is most convenient for them, they will choose how they will express and articulate their appreciation on a more personal basis. So at this time, I'm going to ask if those gentlemen who will be serving as pallbearers, if you'll please line up to my right, your left, those individuals who will be serving as floral attendants, if you would please line up in the outer aisle on my left-hand side, which is your right-hand side, pallbearers to my right, flower attendants to my left, and we will prepare our hearts and minds for the recessional, starting with our ministers. Thank you. Thank you.